Yes.
Okay.
Good evening to one and all. I should first thank the organizers of All Bengal Tax Bar Association for giving us this opportunity to speak in this webinar. In fact, I have to give a special thanks to Mr. Anikesh Banerjee, Mr. Sumit Ghosh for their kind inauguration speech. I should also thank the founder, president, vice president, and secretaries and deputy secretaries of All Bengal Tax Bar Association. The bondage between Calcutta Bar and Madras Tax Bar is for years together. In fact, both the Calcutta High Court as well as the Madras High Court are chartered high courts. Calcutta High Court started in the year 1862 on 1st July. Madras High Court started on 15th August 1862. If you take up the political scenario, Sri Subhash Chandra Bose, Netaji, started his Indian National Army from Calcutta, and most of the Tamil freedom fighters joined and fought for the Indian independence. If you take up spiritual connection, Sri Swami Vivekananda, born in Calcutta, and the memorial rock is in Tamil Nadu at Kanyakumari, which is known to everyone. Why not? Even Sri Aurobindo, born in Calcutta, had his political strength, left everything, and started his ashram in Pondicherry, which is also known to everyone. If you take up judicial thing, two eminent honorable judges from Calcutta came as the Chief Justice of the Honorable Madras High Court and then elevated to Supreme Court. In the year 2008, Honorable Justice A.K. Ganguly came to Madras as the Chief Justice of the Madras High Court, then elevated to the Supreme Court and retired. And the other person is none other than Honorable Justice Indira Banerjee in the year 2017 and now the present sitting judge of the Honorable Supreme Court. In fact, when Indira and the Honorable Justice Indira Banerjee, when she was the Chief Justice of the Madras High Court, she had the specific portfolio of income tax within her domain. In fact, her lordship, in her farewell speech, that the Madras bar is one of the finest bar, was she said at her farewell speech. Why not in income tax? You know all Honorable Justice R.V. Ishwar, born in Tamil Nadu, selected as an ITAT judicial member. His first posting was in Calcutta. Then he became the vice president, became the president, and also elevated to the honorable judge of the Delhi High Court and then retired. And he is the present senior advocate of the Delhi High Court. So if we have to add up the bondage between Calcutta Bar and the Madras Bar, that itself will lead to one other webinar. We will straight away go to the present topic, that is on search assessment. In fact, today we have two eminent speakers, Mr. T.R. Sendil Kumar and Mr. A.P. Srinivas. And both these speakers are holding the portfolio of Centre Circle, the investigation wing. In fact, Mr. T.R. Sendil Kumar is holding the tax case appeals of all the search matters and under Section 260A of the Income Tax Act. And Mr. A.P. Srinivas is handling all the writ and writ appeals in respect of all the search cases. The agenda of this today's search assessment program is that Mr. T.R. Sendil Kumar will be taking us through the section 153A, the assessment of the searched person, 153B, the time limit, and 153D, the approval in respect of the searched person. And Mr. A.P. Srinivas will be handling other than the searched person under section 153C. So now hereby call upon Mr. T.R. Sendil Kumar to take up through the 153A, 153B, and 153D with all case laws also. Over to Mr. T.R. Sendil Kumar.
Thank you, Mr. Swaminathan. And first of all, I thank All Bengal Tax Bar Association for this wonderful opportunity, as well as that of our Madras Tax Bar for this good opportunity given to us to present the subject search assessment before a well good audience of Bengal. Section 153A is now placed in Chapter 17 of the Income Tax Act, and it consists of four sections. First, let us see that 153A, which is about a searched persons, what is the procedure for assessment. In fact, if you can look into 153A, it consisting of two subsections, and in the first subsection, it has got two clauses and four provisos and two explanation. When it comes to subsection 2, there are two provisos are there, and two explanation is also been provided there. First, let us look into the first subsection of 153A. It starts with notwithstanding anything contained under section 139, 147, 148, 149, 151, and 153 in a case of a person. So here is a case. The initiation of a search is a search assessment. A search assessment can be taken up based on the initiation of a search itself is sufficient, and whereby the returns filed under section 139 is to be ignored, and 147 proceedings what has been initiated and 148 notice issued, all subsequent proceedings initiated is also to be totally ignored for the purpose of this search assessment itself. Now, the starting point is no doubt in it, initiation of a search itself is sufficient. On what are the materials? That is the books of account or other documents or any assets requisitioned under section 132A. That is after 31st May 2003, the assessing officer is empowered to make this assessment under 153A. Before that, it was dealt by the block assessment under 158BC BD is concerned. Now, assessing officer, immediate after the search has been completed, completion of search, now he has been empowered to issue a notice. The assessing under class A, the assessing officer himself can issue a notice to the searched person relating to 2-6 assessment years, fixing a date and time limit also, and also requesting the assessee in a prescribed format to file the return of income. That is class A. And class B talks about cases where that assess or reassess the total income of the 6 assessment years relating to the search is concerned. So here the more important wording is that assess or reassess, and as well as that the 6 assessment year, that is the total income of the assessee, and nowhere it has been talking anything about the undisclosed income or any incriminating material, whatever it is. Kindly go to the next slide, please. Now let us come to the provisions under 153 1A itself. The first proviso talks about the assess or reassess the total income in respect of each assessment year falling within the 6 assessment year. So here is a case, there need not be any seized material or any information relating to the 6 assessment years. Even some material what has been found during the course itself is sufficient enough to carry out the assessment relating to all the 6 assessment year is concerned. This is what the first proviso talks about it. Then it comes to the second proviso. Second proviso talks about pending of an, for example, when already an assessment has been completed under 139, what a return filed under section 139. In that case, where 143(2) notice has been issued and it has been pending as on the date of a search. Then in such cases, this second proviso says that 142 notice what has been issued will get abated, and assessing officer is required to proceed under 153A. As such, it is a new assessment itself and can proceed against such assessment. This is the second proviso talks about it. Then comes the third proviso. Third proviso is a very interesting case which normally happens at the time of election periods. For example, some of the persons were being got during the course of election periods by local state government authorities or other authorities concerned, where huge amount of seized cash, material, jewels or other things have also been seized. In such cases, they need not do such a 6 assessment year under 153A. The year relevant to that search assessment has been taken place. During that year itself, they can complete the assessment for one assessment year. That is why rule 112F also deals with such assessment. So fourth proviso, which has been introduced with effect from 1st April 2017. This apart, no doubt in it, the provision talks only about 6 assessment years. But during the course of the search, if an asset, namely land and building, or both, or shares and securities, or loans and advances, or deposit in bank account, which is exceeding 50 lakhs of rupees or more, in which has escaped for assessment in one of the year, in such cases, the assessing officer is empowered not only to assess only 6 assessment year, can go beyond another 4 years, namely up to 10 assessment years, and can proceed with the 153A assessment. So by and large, these are the provisions relating to the 153-1A. Now let us go to subsection 2. Next slide, please. Subsection 2 talks about the if any proceeding initiated or any other any order of assessment or reassessment made under subsection has been annulled in appeal or any other legal proceedings, then notwithstanding anything contained in 153A, now here is a case. For example, there is a written filed by the assessee originally under 139. That was a subject, assume take for a moment that it is an 147 proceeding itself. No doubt, after completion of this 147 proceedings, what is being filed under 139, that was being challenged before the CAT appeals by the assessee. There, the CAT appeal held that the reopening itself is bad in law since there is no new tangible material available for the department to proceed with the 147. Thereby, the 147 proceeding itself has been quashed. Even in such a cases, now based on this 153A proceedings, that annulled assessment also will come to an end. And assessing officer can as such start with the new proceedings under 153A and proceed with the assessment. This is how the subsection 2 talks about it. Now, more important things are on the explanation what has been provided here. For the purpose of this 153A assessment, all the provisions of the Income Tax Act shall be applicable to the assessee. So wherever the deductions and other things, what has been within the provisions of Income Tax Act, should be given benefit to the assessee. This is how the explanation one talks about it. Then more important, the rate of tax is nothing but the maximum rate, namely the 30% plus surcharge and education charges and other things. So that will be applicable to assess the total income of the assessee, unlike that of the old system of block assessment where the rate of tax is 60%. So this is the by and large of section 153A is concerned. Now, I will demonstrate the entire proceedings of this 153A by way of an example. Okay, I'm starting this. Order. And assessee prefers an appeal against that order before the CAT appeals and partly succeeded on two additions. And assessee appeal is pending before the and remaining three additions, he was in appeal before the ITAT. When the date of search, that is on the 1st of September 2018, appeal is pending before the tribunal. Even in that case, whether the assessing officer under 153A, can he proceed with an assessment? Yes, it is possible. Because the word, it has been said that assess or reassess the total income. Now, what are the income that he can make an assessment under 153A? Now, again, he can assess the total income relating to the assessment year 13-14. Other than the whatever the five additions considered by the assessing officer in the original assessment under 143-3, he can look into that. Now, for example, relating to the assessment year 13-14 itself, the assessee has mistakenly claimed a higher rate of depreciation on an plant and machinery. Now, it has been ignored by the assessing officer during the 143-3 proceeding. Now, under 153A, this additional claim of depreciation, what has been made by the claim by the assessee, can be disallowed and bring to tax under 153A. This is how the provisions 153A has been talking about it. Now, let us look into the second year, what is the assessment stages. Then it was a reassessment notice was being issued and it was traveled to the matter up to the commissioner level. And the commissioner also said that there is no new material available for reopening the assessment under 147 and thereby the assessment itself has been quashed by the CAT appeal before the search was being conducted. Even in that case, now under 153A, the assessing officer is empowered to make the reassessment entirely by under 153A. Now let us come to 2015-16. Here, no doubt in it, the assessee has filed a return and it was being processed under section 143-1 and a refund due or whatever is there that has been given back to the assessee. No regular assessment is being taken place. Even in such a situation, the assessee can invoke under 153A, can proceed with the assessment. Now, the fourth year, namely, there is no regular assessment, no 143.3 also, 143.1 also is also been done. Here also, the assessing officer can go into the entire books of account and proceed with the assessment under 153A. Now, the fifth year, let us come to the case about the pendency. Now, abatement and pending, what has been discussed under section second proviso to the 153A, 1A. Here is a case, there were time limit for completing assessment is been there, but however, 143.2 notice has been issued, assessment proceedings is been going on. In that case, now this proceeding is to be abated. Now, assessing officer has to issue on the issuance of a 153A notice, the assessing officer can proceed against the new assessment instead of the 143.2 notice, what has been issued against the original return filed by the assessee. Then 18-19, in fact, no assessment has been done. Even in that case, the assessee can proceed with the assessment of the case itself. So this is how 153A literally interprets about the to proceed with the 153A assessments. Now let us go to the second issue, second section, namely the 153B. Next slide, please. This is the case, the previous one. This is 153C. Thank you. So there are a time limit have been prescribed from time to time as far as completion of either a searched person assessment as well as that of a connected person, other person's assessments also. Here I tabulated that in a simple format. So as far as whereas a search has been conducted up to 31st March 2008 for six assessment years and also the searched assessment year, the time limit is 21 months from the end of the financial year in which the conclusion of the search, that is conclusion means the last panchanama drawn by the department on concluding the search itself, that period, end of that month period, that 21 months is to be calculated. Now, assume a man from where the search has been conducted on or after 1/4/2008 is concerned, now the time limit of 21 months has been reduced to 18 months. And the same thing like that of the conclusion of the search, namely the panchanama, last panchanama drawn. Now, after 1/4/2019 onwards, the time limit has been further reduced to only 12 months because it is not a case that assessee is not being assessed to tax itself. So when already assessment has been done and based on some materials or books of account, the department is required to complete the assessment within 12 months period. And there is no question of further time has been given to the department to complete the assessment. So this is how for 153A, all the time limit has been given. Now let us look into the case of a person. Yes, other person. The previous slide, please. Other person. Now there is a search in the case of A. There are some materials relating to X is been found. Now parallelly 153C proceedings is also been initiated. What is the time limit available for such cases? Time limit has been prescribed as tabulated in this table. As far as the search is conducted up to 31st March 2018 for six assessment year and also the searched assessment year, 21 months as like the, that of the from the end of the financial year which the conclusion of search or 9 months from the end of the year financial year in which the seized documents handed over to the assessing officer having jurisdiction, whichever is later. So now, for example, that there are relating to the seized material relating to X is been handed over to the concerned assessing officer. For example, the search has been taken place at Chennai and the materials relating to X has been available at he's been assessed at Calcutta. Now, the time taken by the assessing officer from Chennai to transfer the files to Calcutta, from that, the maximum period that he can take 9 months from the end of the financial year in which the seized document is handed over to the assessing officer. So this is how the calculation is to be done. Now, where is the case that the search has been concluded between 1/4/2018 to 31st March 2019, then the 21 months have been reduced to 18 months. And from the receipt of the files, seized materials and seized material, it is a 12 months they have been getting the time limit to complete the assessment. When it is a case where the search has been conducted on or after 1st April 2019, it is reduced to 12 months from the end of the financial year where the conclusion of the search, or 12 months from the end of the financial year where the seized documents has been handed over to the arresting officer. So maximum here, the arresting officer almost about getting about 24 months to complete the entire assessment itself from the date of last panchanama what has been drawn. So this is how the time limit as far as the other connected person is being provided. This apart, next slide please. Swami, next slide. This apart, when there are some cases, next slide. When there are cases where that this 153A proceeding during the course of the assessment proceeding, the assessee has been challenged before the court of law by way of a writ petition or some other proceeding, something like that. In that case, where the court has granted a stay, in such a case, the time given, the time where the stay was being enjoyed by the assessee is to be excluded, and 60 days is the time limit available for the assessing officer to complete the entire assessment, subject to, suppose if the writ petition filed by the assessee got dismissed at the end of the day, and again directing the assessing officer to proceed with the assessment, in that case he gets 60 days time. Similarly, where a case complicated nature of books of account is being maintained and a special audit is being referred under section 142(2)(a), in that case also similarly extended time of 60 days is been available to the assessing officer. Similarly, in a case where about the valuation of the property has been referred to the district valuation officer, and then in such cases, and similarly in a case where a new assessing officer has been taking charge of such an assessment circle, in that case also you're getting it. Similarly, for the case of settlement commission, where the case has been pending before the settlement commission or the AR also, and as well as in the case of a transfer pricing cases also, the time will get extended by 60 days. So these are the time limit what has been very clearly prescribed under section 153B of the Income Tax Act. Now let us come to the fourth provisions of this income tax. The fourth provision, 153D, talks about the prior approval necessary for assessment in case of search and construction, search or requisition. Here, the assessing officers are not less than the rank of Assistant Commissioner of Income Tax or Deputy Commissioner of Income Tax, and they should get the necessary permission and approval from the Joint Commissioner of the concerned Joint Commissioner of Income Tax before passing such an 153A assessment order, or even if it is a 153C or the other person cases also, they should get the prior approval from the assessing officer. So by and large, these are the provisions relating to the new search assessment is concerned. And as well as interest and penalty also, that we will address it in a later part of this session. Now, in submission of my presentation before this, I would like to rely upon some of the judgments. And of course, this 153A, whether seized material is required or not, various high courts have given verdicts in favor of the assessee, in favor of the department, and still it has not attained a conclusion, and only SLP stages, only one or two cases got dismissed, and still it is an arguable case both for the assessees as well as that of the department. Now just I will take through some of the judgments relating to the provisional search assessment. The search assessment was been introduced with effect from 1/5/2003 onwards. No doubt on it, that was being challenged before the Delhi High Court, saying that no proper opportunity was being given and it has been held to be ultra vires. But there the Delhi High Court held that there is no hostile discrimination between two categories of persons, namely the searched person and the connected person. And furthermore, the principle of natural justice are incorporated under 153C and postulate that the assessing officer shall proceed against person covered by the section issuing notice to him for purpose of assessing or reassessing his income, and thereby held that the constitution, the constitutional validity of the provisions of section 153A and C to be good in law. But again, this order, it appears to be there is no further SLP against this order, so it has attained finality. On my search, I do not find any other law, case laws challenging the constitutional validity. Now, as I stated, the opening paragraph itself of 153A, the initiation of a search itself is sufficient enough. Now, on that count, I would like to rely upon the Karnataka High Court judgment in the case of Canara Housing Development and Company, which is reported in 49taxman.com 98, where it has been categorically held it that Section 153A is that there should be a search under Section 132. However, initiation of a proceeding is not dependent on any undisclosed income being unearthed during the course of search. So in this line, study, I've been also hoping that initiation of a search itself is sufficient enough to proceed with an search assessment. Next slide, please. Then, as I stated earlier, there is no word or phraseology incriminating or undisclosed is being available under 153A. To this extent, I rely upon Kerala High Court judgment. It is in the case of CIT Thrissur versus St. Francis Clay Decor Tiles, where it has been held that whether neither under the Section 132 or under 153A, phraseology incriminating is used by Parliament. Therefore, any material which is unearthed during search operation of or any statement made during the course of search by assessee is a valuable piece of evidence in order to invoke 153A, and it has been held in favor of the department. Next slide, please. Again, reiterating on the same thing, whether it is a see-through material is being required or not. Now, here only not of same length of judgments is being available in favor of the assessee that I am discussing in the next slides also. Here it is in the case of CIT versus Chetan Das Lakshman Das, Delhi High Court, has said that there is no condition under 153A that addition should be strictly be made on the basis of evidence found in course of search or other post-search material or information available with the assessing officer which can be related to evidence found. So there also Delhi High Court held in favor of the department. The next one is, now another interesting question will also arise. In the course of search, no doubt in it, some materials relating to the assessee, relating to out of six assessment areas, one assessment area has been available. If it is the case, whether all the six assessment areas to be reopened or relating to the seizure material, there again, Kerala High Court, it is in the case of Sunny Jacob Jewelers and Wedding Center versus DCIT, has held there is no requirement under the provisions of Act requiring department to collect information and evidence for each and every six or previous year in order to initiate proceedings under 153A, and it has been affirmed by the in favor of the department. So the next course, slide please. Now, the second proviso talks about the abatement and as well as the pending. In fact, this is a very interesting judgment rendered by Allahabad High Court. It is in the case of CIT Central Kanpur versus Shaila Agarwal, where they have dealt it very elaborately. What is the meaning of a word abatement as well as that of the pending? Here, they have discussed about the case as I narrated above. Now, a return filed under Section 139. It got assessed, it traveled to CIT appeal, and again further appeal pending before the tribunal. Even in that case, that 139 returns is to be totally ignored for the purpose of assessment. And again, we need to proceed only against the 153A, again by way of a new assessment. This is how this judgment has been dealt in. The next slide, please. Next slide, sorry. Here, in para 13 of the judgment has made it very clear, the word abatement is referable to something which is pending, alive, or subject to deduction. The abatement refers to suspension or termination of proceedings either of the main action or the proceeding ancillary or collateral to it. The word is commonly used in the legislation which provide an abatement of action, suit, abatement of legacies, abatement of, the previous one. So this judgment has dealt it very clearly, and even pending, it talks only about a case where the assessment is been pending, not any appellate proceedings what has been pending. So all the appellate proceedings, even for example, now the appeal is pending before the tribunal. Again, the original assessment order, assuming the moment the assessing officer has initiated a 271C penalty, that will also continue against the 139 return filed by the assessee. it will not have any bearing with the 153A. And 153A, again, a new proceeding needs to be initiated, looking into the books of account and what are the seized material, whatever it is, and proceeding under 153A. So this was a judgment which has been not considered in the later judgment, what is in favor of the assessees. The next judgment, please. Next slide, sorry. This is about talking about the provisions of section 1, proviso 1 and 2, all the six assessment years, as well as that abatement, all these things, Anil Kumar Bhatia in favor of the department. And this is the special tribunal, special bench of the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal judgment. It is in the case of All Cargo Global Logistics Limited, where in this case, where the tribunal, special tribunal has held that there should be some seized material for the purpose of making an assessment. Without incriminating material, the pending assessments cannot be proceeded. This was the view taken by the special bench of the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal. Over to the next slide. Next slide, please. So this was been challenged by the department before the Bombay High Court, and where which has been held against the department. However, here they are not considered about the abatement. What is the meaning of abatement, as well as of the pending assessment in this judgment? No doubt in it, SLPs have been filed against this judgment, which has been admitted as of 12th October 2015. I believe that it's still pending before the Honorable Supreme Court, Continental Warehousing Corporation. So this is how it has been held in favor of the assessees. And this judgment has been often referred by the assessees in various case laws, various high courts. And now it is in the case of Kabul Chawla, where they also relied upon this continental warehousing and held that for making the assessment, there should be a seized material and held in favor of the other. But here is also a case, actually, after completion of a 153A proceedings, when 154 petition was been filed, that was been rejected by the assessing officer, and that made an appeal before the commissioner appeals. And when it comes to the tribunal, the entire track has been changed about that there is no seized material. The question of assessment itself is bad in law, following continental judgment and held against in favor of the assessee. So, but here also the case that they are not considered the Allahabad High Court judgment. And this is also a very interesting case in the case of Meeta Gutia arising from Delhi High Court judgment itself. And of course, there are four case laws, four tax cases filed by the department before the Supreme Court. What was been dismissed, as it can be seen from the SLP number 18121 of 2018, only one SLP got dismissed relating, in fact, it is also silent about which assessment year. But of course, this is for 2004 and 5. Still, the SLP filed by the department is also pending before the Honorable Supreme Court. And this is also a simple case of SLP dismissal, not a very detailed order. So with this, I conclude the session relating to the 153A, 153B, and 153D. And then I request Mr. A.P. Srinivas to discuss about 153C. And I am handing over this to Mr. Swaminathan.
Thank you, T.S. Anil Kumar. You have discussed threadbare the decision of 153A. In fact, with the 153B time limit and the approval, with including with the various judgments also. Now, I would like to call upon Mr. A.P. Srinivas. Mr. Srinivas, you can just explain us about the 153C, because he has spoken about the searched person, but now I want the information about the other than the searched person. So please kindly enlighten us on those issues. APS.
Yes.
Yeah, Srinivas, it is, the slide share is there.
Good evening to all. I think it's very happy Subha Sandhya to all of you. I hope Subha Sandhya is good evening in Bengali. So now I am going to speak about section 153C, that's about assessment in case of the other person, other than the searched person. 153C has two subsections, 153C1 and 153C2. So this is verbatim reproduction of section 153C1. We will analyze this section in the coming slides. So 153C2. So what are the key elements of section 153C1? So 153C is applicable to the person other than the searched person. So the searched person is assessed under 153A, and all other persons are assessed under, in respect of whom materials have been discovered, they will be assessed under 153C. And it is, again, it is a notwithstanding provision as similar to 153A. It is notwithstanding 139, 147 and the other sections. Now, in what circumstances the 153C can be invoked? So when the assessing officer is satisfied, first, any money, bullion or jewelry or other valuable article or thing seized or requisitioned is belongs to. So the first condition is money, bullion, jewelry belongs to the other person. The second one is any books of accounts or documents seized or requisitioned pertains or pertains to. And the third category is, or any information contained there is relates to. There are three circumstances we can link the other person into 153C. Of course, the first condition, the any money bullion which belongs to, this was the position up to the year 2015. Then in the year 2015, the act was amended to include the further two circumstances. Now, after the amendment, which is a prospective amendment, is applicable with effect from 1-6-2015. Now, even in these circumstances, merely when the department is able to show that these books of accounts or documents are pertains to some other person or any information is relates to that person, then also 153C can be invoked. So this is the key change with effect from 1-6-2015, and it's a prospective amendment, and Gujarat High Court also held so. And the next thing, these materials shall be handed over to the assessing officer having jurisdiction over such other person. Here also there is no dispute. Then the assessing officer shall proceed and issue notice and assess or reassess the income of the other person in accordance with the provisions of section 153A. So when records are handed over, the assessing officer of the other person has to assess in accordance with section 153A. So otherwise the assessment procedures are in pari materia with 153A only. And the next category, if that assessing officer, when he can assess, so when he is satisfied, that is the assessing officer of the other person is satisfied that the books of accounts or documents or assets are have been bearing on the determination of the total income of such another person. So this assessing officer can assess the other person only after coming to a conclusion that by relying upon these books of accounts or documents, it will have a bearing on the determination of the total income. So once all these conditions are satisfied, then only 153C can be invoked. And it again is applicable to how many years? This again is also similar to 6 assessment years as stated in 153A. So here I have highlighted in red to indicate that though the 6 assessment years as stated in 153C and 153A are in pari materia, are more or less one and the same assessment years. However, the Delhi High Court in RRJ Securities held that by relying upon the proviso, it has held that no, the 6 assessment is for 153C has to be reckoned from the date when the materials have been handed over to the assessing officer. Of course, it may not be a correct judgment because the section is very clear. Anyhow, it's an abundant caution. The act has been amended with effect from financial year 14-2017. And the relevant assessment is there is no change. Then we can go back up to 10 years. That's beyond 6 years when the asset has been suppressed and the cumulative effect of 50 lakhs either for the same assessment there or for the entire relevant assessment years. So then the assessment can go back up to 10 assessment years. So in this, and considering the total composition or the ingredients of section 153C, now we have to see when the documents recovered is belongs to the other person or it pertains to or it relates to, in all this category 153C can be invoked. Then the assessing officer is to record the satisfaction and hand over to the assessing officer of the other person. So one satisfaction by the assessing officer of the searched person. Then another satisfaction by the receiving assessing officer of the other person. Then for the 6 assessment year. So these are the key ingredients. So with regard to satisfaction, just we have seen, there are two satisfactions are required. So one by the assessing officer of the searched person, and another satisfaction by the assessing officer on the other person who is going to be assessed under 153C. Now the question is, when the assessing officer on the search, when he has to record the assessing officer on the searched person, at what stage he can record saying that these materials belong to other person? Because this is one of the important judgment by the Supreme Court, Honorable Supreme Court of India, the case of Calcutta Networks. In three circumstances, the assess, three stages, the assessing officer can record the satisfaction. So one, at that, when the this is recording satisfaction by the assessing officer, the searched person who is going to be assessed under 153A. He has to record satisfaction at three stages. One, at the time or along with the initiation of proceedings against the searched person, of course, this judgment was given in the context of block assessment under 150BC and BD, and still the ratio holds good. So either at the time of the initiation of proceedings against the person under 153A or along with the assessment or in the course of assessment, when he comes to the conclusion saying that it is to be, it belongs to other person, then at that point of time also he can record satisfaction. And the third category is, even at the conclusion of the assessment he can record. So in all these three stages he can record, because the recording the satisfaction by the assessing officer of the 153A is relevant, because once he records satisfaction and he handed over to 153C assessing officer, then only the limitation can be computed for the purpose of assessment under 153C. So these are the three stages he can record satisfaction and transmit the record to the assessing officer or the other person. So when he records satisfaction after the completion of the assessment of the person searched under 132 to be assessed under 153A, within a reasonable time he has to record the satisfaction, and only the limitation is there. Next. So the next question is, when the assessing officer of the searched person and the other person are one and the same. So this, the earlier judgment was that there must be two satisfaction to be recorded, one by the assessing officer under 153A and another by the assessing officer under 153C. The CBDT also issued a circular number 24/2015 and clarified that the provisions of section 153C are substantially similar peri materia to the provisions of section 158BD. This circular further clarified that even if the assessing officer is the searched person and the other person is one and the same, then he is also required to record his satisfaction as he has been held by the courts. But after this circular, now there are some latest judgments which says otherwise. So when one the assessing officer is the searched person and as well as the other person are one and the same, there need not to be two satisfaction to be recorded, and the satisfaction recorded by the officer under 153A is enough to initiate assessment against the other person under 153C. So the Delhi High Court judgment in the case of Ganapati Fincap Services, this summarizes the legal principles in respect of assessment under 153C. There are seven principles they have held. Just I will read one by one. The first legal position summarizes: one, no search under 132(1) of that can be initiated without a satisfaction note being recorded on the searched person. This is followed by issuance of notice to searched person under section 2. At that stage, the AO does not have to record another satisfaction note for the searched person, because the search itself is commences after recording satisfaction note only. Then the second summarization: where proceedings are proposed to be initiated under section 153C of the Act against the other person, it has to be preceded by a satisfaction note by the AO of the searched person. That is, the satisfaction to be recorded by assessing officer under 153A. He will record in the satisfaction the seized document belongs to the other person. Depending on the nature and contents of the document, to be required to give some reasons for such conclusion. And the third summarization: where the AO of the searched person is different from the AO of the other person, the AO will simultaneously with transmitting the documents along with the satisfaction note to the AO of the other person, make a note in the file of the searched person that he has done so. But this is for administrative convenience. The failure by the AO of the searched person after preparing and dispatching the satisfaction note and documents to the AO of the other person to make a note to that effect in the file of the searched person will not initiate the proceedings under section 153C against the other person. then the fourth, that the ego of the searched person and the other person is the same, such a satisfaction note for the other person has to be recorded by the ego of the searched person prior to the initiation of the proceedings against the other person. This is a sine qua non for triggering the proceedings against the other person under section 153C of the Act. There is no doubt, no, there do not have to be two separate satisfaction notes prepared by the ego of the searched person, even where he is also the ego of the other person. In such event, the ego need make only one satisfaction note. That satisfaction note is for the other person. Further, it is sufficient that such satisfaction note is placed in the file of the other person by the ego in his capacity as the ego of such other person. It is only in certain cases that the document is such that it may belong to more than one person, including the searched person, that the ego will have to indicate in the satisfaction note the reasons why he is of the opinion that the document belongs to the other person and not the searched person. And seven, where the ego of the searched person records that the seized document in question belongs to the other person, where necessary gives the reasons, therefore the requirement of section 153C stands satisfied. The failure by the ego in such a case to record in the satisfaction note that such document does not belong to the searched person will not initiate the proceedings under section 153C against the other person. So the Delhi High Court categorically says that when the assessing officer or the searched person and the other person is one and the same, there need not to be two satisfaction notes, and one satisfaction note by recorded by the assessing officer under 153 is enough, and he has to keep a copy in the file of that satisfaction in the 153 person, saying that these documents belong to the other person. So once this is done, 153C can be initiated against the other person. Now there is a recent Supreme Court judgment in the case of Super Malts Limited versus PCAT. The ratio is this: in case where the assessing officer is the searched person and the other person is the same, there can be one satisfaction note prepared by the assessing officer, as he himself is the assessing officer of the searched person, and also the assessing officer of the other person. However, as observed here in the book, he must be conscious and satisfied that the documents seized are recovered from the searched person belong to the other person. In such a situation, the satisfaction note would be for the other person. The second requirement of transmitting the documents so seized from the searched person would not be there, as he himself will be the assessing officer, the searched person and the other person, and therefore there is no question of transmitting such a seized documents to himself. And in fact, they affirmed the Delhi High Court judgment. So now the position, legal position as of now is, once the assessing officer, the searched person and other person is one and the same, there need not to be two satisfaction note. Then the next issue is whether the six assessment years can be assessed under 153 is same as that of 153A or not. So the section is clear, the six assessment years are as referred to in subsection 1 of section 153A. However, the Delhi High Court in RRJ securities came to a different conclusion because of the proviso which is in the second part of the slide. This is with regard to time of abatement of the pending assessment. So under 153A, once the search is initiated, automatically the pending assessments are abated. But this is not the case in 153C, because the assessing officer of the 153C person will not be aware of the search at all. So the abatement in case of 153C arises only when these records have been reached the assessing officer, he is going to be assessed under 153C. So therefore, this proviso emphasizes that so the date of abatement as provided in 153A has to be seen in the context of when the documents have been handed over to the assessing officer or the other person. This proviso has been wrongly relied on by the Delhi High Court, and they come to the conclusion in RRJ Securities to say that the six assessment years are different from the 153A. However, it's an abundant caution. Now the law is abundant with effect from 1/4/2017. Now the six assessment years of 153A and 153C are one and the same only. Now the second part of 153C, where what about the assessment in case of current year of search? For example, a search happens today, whether this assessment period can be assessed under 153C? It is not provided in 153A. So suppose if a search is happened today, this assessment, the current assessment here, cannot be assessed in 153A. But this is not the situation in 153C. Because why this provision has been incorporated in 153C alone, and of course it's originally when search assessment proceedings are introduced in the Act in the year 2003, this was not there. This was introduced with the effect from Finance Act 2005 with retrospective effect from 16-2003. So why there is necessity to include this section in 153C alone? Because as we seen earlier, when the AO of the 153A, searched person under 153A can record satisfaction, he has option to record satisfaction at three stages. Either at the time of receiving the searched material, or during the assessment, or after the completion of the assessment. Suppose in case the assessment itself is complete, because the assessee approaches settlement commission or he goes to High Court and gets some stay, because of that the assessment is prolonged. So after 5 or 6 years only, when he is able to complete the assessment under 153A, then also he can transmit the records to 153C. So at that time, the assessing officer would have lost the limitation to assess those 6 assessment years. Otherwise, even under 147, the maximum limitation is 6 years only, 4+2, and thereafter 10 when income is suppressed in foreign country. So in normal circumstances, 4+2 only. So only to overcome that situation, when suppose hard cash is seized in the current era of search, how it has to be assessed in the case of other person. So therefore, this provision has been introduced. This is not the case in 153A. This is in 153C only. So when this 153C2 can be invoked, first, when the records have been handed over to the assessing officer, jurisdiction over such other person, after the due date for furnishing the return, this is the first condition. And what are the three circumstances? A, when no return of income has been furnished by such other person, and no notice under 142(1) has been issued, and R, B, a return of income has been furnished by such other person, but no notice under 143(2) has been served, and limitation for serving the notice under 143(2) has also expired, or assessment or reassessment, if any, has been met. In all these three circumstances, 153C2 for the current year of sales can be done by the assessing officer. And before the date of receiving the books of account or documents or assessees are requested by the assessing officer having jurisdiction such assessor, such assessing officer shall issue the notice and reassess total income of such other person of such assessment year in the manner provided in 153A. So in respect of the current year of search, in respect of the other person, 153C2 can be invoked when a no return is filed, or a return is filed, 143(2) has not been issued, or limitation issued, or even assuming the assessment or reassessment has been done. So even in that circumstances, 153C2 can be invoked. So with this, I have summarized what is 153C1 and 153C2. And I thank all taxpayer, all Bengal Taxpayer Association for giving us this opportunity. And in the question and answer sessions, we will be answering more questions. With this, I conclude my lecture. And thank you, one and all.
Thank you. Thank you, AP Srinivas. In fact, you have dealt with 153C, the same year, abatement, current year, initial years, then the satisfaction note. In fact, you have dealt with the Manish Maheshwari judgment. How it has to be differentiated has also been dealt in a perfect manner. Thank you for the... before going to the floor for questions, I have certain 3 questions to the speakers. With the permission, I think I can shoot up those questions to the speakers. Sendhil, are you ready for the questions? Sendhil, unmute yourself so that I can shoot up 2 questions because having touched by AP Srinivas on the block assessment, when there is a block assessment in the legislation itself, what is the necessity for present assessment, why it is required?
Yes, thank you Swaminathan for the good questions what has been raised to me. In fact, if you can look into, I have made a small comparison with that of the old system of block assessment and that of the present search assessment. There is a very great differences between the old system and the new system. Let us go one after other. In the old block assessment, it was been found place in chapter 14B of the Income Tax Act, dealing with 158 BC to BE of the Income Tax Act, which was been there from 1st of July 1995 till 31st March 2003. In fact, the main criteria of that block assessment is that there should be some seized material, undisclosed income of an assessee, which is liable to be taxed in the block assessment. What is the rate of tax is also at the rate of 60%. And no doubt in it, when this block assessment was been introduced under the Act in 1995, the block years were been running up to 10 assessment years. Then after it was been reduced to 6 assessment years. So in the old block assessment system, there were two parallel assessments were being there. As against the original returns filed by the assessee, what has been disclosed, a regular assessment will be taking place pursuant to a search, as well as that of a block assessment. What was the undisclosed income of the assessee? What has been unearthed during the course of search? What has been not disclosed to the department? All that thing has been done under the block assessment 158 either BC on a searched person, or 158 BD in the case of a connected person or the other person is being concerned. So this was the main issues relating to block assessment is there. And moreover, the question of penalty is been there. It has been categorized under section 158 BFA1, where interest is been charged, and 158 B2, it is equivalent to 271C penalty was been levied. This was the old system was been there. In fact, many of the cases which were been struck down by various judicial forums that it is not an undisclosed income of the assessee. Thereby, the entire block assessment was a futile exercise for the department. That made the legislation to bring a new system of assessment to bring to tax not the undisclosed income, but that of the total income of the assessee relating to the same assessment years. So the main difference between the old block assessment and the new search assessment is that old assessment, there should be undisclosed income should be there. But whereas in the case of the new search assessment, it is the total income is to be assessed. And the main important point for new search assessment, there need not be any seized material at all. Initiation of a search itself is sufficient enough to proceed with the assessment. And here, assess the total income, assess or reassess the total income. As I stated earlier, where there is already an 143.3 has been completed, or a 147 proceeding is also been completed, which get abated subsequently. Even in that cases, the assessing officer is empowered to reassess the total income under 153A or 153C as it may be applicable to the assessee's concern. So here also now the interesting point of is the rate of taxes, the maximum rate is 30%. When it is a case of an individual assuming a moment, where out of 6 assessment years, even the first or second assessment year, there's no income of the assessee, or the income is less than the taxable limit. In that case, no tax can be charged under the new provisions of the new search assessment itself. And here, as like that of a regular assessment year, when it comes to the question of penal provisions, namely the charging of interest under section 234A(b)(c), as well as the penalty is concerned, the regular provisions of section 234A(b)(c) will be applicable when the assessee failed to file the return of income, belatedly file the return of income, non-payment of taxes. All the provisions of section 234A(b)(c) will be applicable to the assessee's concern. When it is a case of a penalty is concerned, for the 6 assessment years, the provisions of section 271(1)(c), very particularly the 5th proviso, will be applicable to the searched cases. When it comes for the year of search, a new provision, namely called as 271AAA, and then after it has been amended as a 271AB will be AAB will be applicable. So this is the main distinction between the old block assessment and that of the new assessment. In fact, in even the new search assessment, it has been argued that there should be a seized material, which word is never been found in 153A proceeding itself. So the question of adopting that the old analogy to the new search assessment does not applicable.
Having touched up the penalty provisions as well as the search, I will skip out that the penalty and interest, but I want to ask one question. Suppose, yes, can I make a fresh claim in the return filed in response to 153A? Is it possible, Mr. Sandhil? See, because you asked me to file a return. I am filing the return. Can I make a fresh claim? My assessment has not been completed. Can you give me that?
In fact, as I stated earlier, as per section 153A subsection 2, explanation 1 talks about a case that same or otherwise provided under section 153B or 153C, all other provisions of this act shall apply to the assessment made under this section. So, shall apply to. So, here, the new claim, for example, in the original return under filed under 139, as I stated earlier, the assessee failed to claim a depreciation. No doubt in it, that depreciation that pursuant to a 153A notice or a 153C notice, the assessee can make such a claim. But when it comes to deductions, namely 80I, 80IA, 80IB10 or some other deduction, that deductions is being carried out with filing the original return of income as per 139. So such deductions should not be allowed under the search assessment. For a small, for example, some expenses what has been failed to claim, that can be, he can make a claim under 153A or 153C is concerned, but the deductions cannot be claimed. That is my view of this provision.
I think JSW Steels, they have taken a different view, I feel so, that they have allowed for that.
There the specific claim is about the, it is in the case of Rajasthan High Court, there they held that it cannot be made a claim under 153A. No doubt in it, there is one more judgment of Bombay High Court in favor of the assessee that this claim should be allowed in favor of the assessee.
Sandhil, but before going to the other question, I want to have a specific question is that, see, because the approval has been given by some authorities, you have stated 153C. Is there any possibility that 263 is possible under 153A and 153C?
Yes.
Search matters. Whether 263 is possible?
Yes, it's a really a very interesting question itself, Swaminathan. Because as per section 153D, the sanctioning authority of all these assessments, namely 153A or 153C, is a joint commissioner. Now, 263 is being invoked by the Commissioner of Income Tax exercising power under section 263 vested with him. When there is a prejudicial, when an order passed is erroneous or prejudicial to the interest of revenue. In such a cases, when the Commissioner of Income Tax come across such a error in the assessment or which is prejudicial to the interest of revenue, 263 can be invoked against an order passed by the assessing officer. So 263 can be invoked.
Thank you, Sandhil. Wonderful presentation on that 3 points and other thing. Now, I just want to ask one question to Mr. A.P. Srinivas. Mr. A.P. Srinivas, you have touched up the other person, 153A, 153C and all those things. I want to have a specific question this one. Hotel Blue Moon contemplates 153.2 is mandatory. This is an hot topic which is going on in all the courts. Whether 153.2 notice, is it mandatory for 153A as well as 153C? Please kindly tell me that.
143.2 notice.
143.2 notice, absolutely.
I'll answer.
Yeah. Since being an hot topic, as of now, because...
answer this case.
Yes.
See, the Hotel Blue Moon judgment mandating a notice to be issued under 143.2 is in the block assessment era. Because we all of us know what is 143.2 notice. When a return is filed under 139 or the assessing officer issue a notice under 142.1 asking you to file a return, then in those cases 143.2 notice has to be issued for scrutiny assessment. To scrutinize the assessment. A mere issuance of notice will not prejudice the department. This question may not have significance whether a notice be issued or not. Of course, Even under 153A and 153C, notices have been issued to the assessee and questioner, and the assessees will be given fair opportunity of hearing. The significance of 143-2 arises only because it comes with a time limit. So if a 143-2 notice has been issued, there is a time limit under 143-2, the proviso says. Because after the expiry of 6 months from the end of the financial year, in which the return is furnished, right, notice cannot be issued. So suppose if the assessing officer slept over the case, once the return is filed and he slept over for a period of 6 months from the end of the financial year, whether he can proceed. So therefore, this 143-2 notice becomes significant. So in the block assessment, the Supreme Court in the case of CIT versus Blue Moon held that 143-2 notice is mandatory. Why they have come to the conclusion, we have to see. See, in the earlier assessment proceedings under 158BC and BD, in respect of block assessment, you can see 158BH first, what is provided. Save as otherwise provided in this chapter, all other provisions of this Act shall apply to assessment made under this chapter. This was under 14B, this assessment under special procedure under 14B. So 158BH says all other provisions of this Act shall apply to assessment made under this chapter. So automatically 143-2 will apply. But the condition what we have to see is save as otherwise provided. Whether this 143-2 is saved or otherwise anything provided in this Act. So for which you see 158BC subsection B, it specifically says to determine the undisclosed income as per section 158BB, the provisions of section 142, subsection 2 and 3 of section 143 shall so far as may be applied. So 158BH says all other provisions applicable, and 158BC subsection B says that 143-2 notice has to be issued and this provision shall so far as may be applied. So by relying upon these two sections, 158BH and 158BC subsection B, the Supreme Court came to the conclusion saying that 143-2 notice is mandatory. Now let us see the present assessment sections under 153A and 153C, whether such a word is there. Now you see 153A. So here also there is a saving clause. After the explanation, explanation is ordered, all you can see. For the removal of doubts, it is hereby declared that save as otherwise provided in this section. Section 153B, this section means 153A, 153B and 153C. All other provisions of this Act shall apply to the assessment made under this section. So the explanation makes it clear all the provisions of this Act shall apply to the assessment. Because this provision is necessary because to invoke, to levy penalty, interest and collection of tax and all, we depends on the other provisions of the Act and for other purposes also. So therefore, this condition is enough. So all other provisions of this Act apply. And the explanation save clearly says, save as otherwise provided. So we have to see whether anything is otherwise provided in this section. So now we go to the upper part of the section. Now 153A and 153C is not concerned in non-abstracted clauses that we have already seen. So it starts with the phrase not concerning anything contained in one section 139. So we'll skip the other portions. So we'll stop here, not concerning anything contained in section 139. So it clearly says section 139 is not applicable. But in the subsection A, you see again the word 139 is quoted. So we will read subsection small a. It says, issue notice to such person requiring him to furnish within such period as may be specified in the notice the return of income in respect of each assessment year falling within 6 assessment years and for the relevant assessment year or years referred to in clause B in the prescribed form and verified in the prescribed manner and setting forth such other particulars as may be prescribed and the provisions of this Act shall so far as may be applied accordingly as if such return were a return required to be furnished under section 139. Here the words used are so far as may be applied accordingly as if such a return were a return required to be furnished under 139. The section doesn't say that or doesn't deem that it's a return filed under 139. It says it has to be a written has to be filed as if one of a condition to be filed under 139. So we all of us know when a 139 return has to be filed, whenever income exceeds the taxable limit, or when we fall under the six conditions, we are occupying a particular area of immovable property, when we have traveled to foreign countries, we have used a credit card, there are some circumstances. So only in those circumstances, 139 return has to be filed. So it merely says 153A1, subsection A says that it is a return has to be filed under 153A, as if it's a return required to be furnished under 139. Nowhere the section deems the return filed under 153A as a return filed under 139. So therefore, we cannot say that it's a return filed under 139. Therefore, 143 to notice has to be issued. So this is the crux. So now we come to the first point, notwithstanding anything contained in 139. So by using the two expressions, notwithstanding anything contained in 139, and also in the second part, a return required to be furnished under 139, there is no contra. So it mutually complements each other. What the return required to be filed under 153A and 153C under this act, under this section only, and the provisions of section 139 is not applicable. So once section 139 is not applicable, the question of issuing notice under 143 too doesn't arise. So this is the view by the Delhi High Court in the case of Ashok Chadha versus Income Tax Arisa. There the conclusion is, so far as may be in class, subsection 1 of 153A could not be interpreted that the issuance of notice under 143(2) was mandatory in case of assessment under 153A. The use of the word so far as may be cannot be stretched to the extent of mandatory issuance of notice under 143(2). As is noted, a specific notice was required to be issued under class A of subsection 1 of section 153A, calling upon the person searched or requisitioned to file return. That being so, no further notice under 143(2) could be contemplated for assessment under 153A. The notice issued under 153A or under 153C asking the assessee to file a return is enough, and no further notice under 143(2) is required. And they hold that the law laid down in Hotel Blue Moon is not applicable to the facts of the present case. This Delhi High Court judgment was followed by other two High Courts, one by the Punjab and Haryana in the case of Tarsem Singla versus CCIT, says that there is no mandatory requirement of issuance of notice under 143(2) in respect of assessment proceedings under 153A. They followed Ashok Chadha, and the High Court of Kerala followed both Delhi High Court judgment and as well as Punjab and Haryana High Court judgment in the case of Tarsem Singla, and they come to the conclusion that there is no requirement of notice under 143(2) for completing an assessment under 153C, and if that be so, the question of time limit prescribed under the provision of section 143 does not have any relevance for assessment under section 153C. See, all the three High Courts have come to the same conclusion, and the section itself are very clear. It's a non-abstentive clause. It starts with the phrase notwithstanding anything contained in 139, and in the subsection A also it says that it's only a written record to be furnished under 139, and it is not at all deemed or it is considered as a written file under 139. So therefore, in my opinion, the issuance of notice under 143(2) doesn't arise. So the assessees cannot still saying that the Blue Moon judgment is applicable. Now it becomes a once in a Blue Moon judgment. So it is not applicable to the present era of such assessment.
You mean to say that one, there need not be a once if it is in such case, it is yes. Not 148 is not that, therefore 153A notice or 153C notice itself to file the return. Therefore, where is the question of 143(2) and other things?
143(2) need not to be issued.
Need not be issued. So at least an opportunity.
Is yes to complete.
Complete. So
the only problem is the time limit comes with 143(2). Therefore, this topic becomes significant. So in case of such assessment, issuance of notice under 143(2) doesn't arise.
Because this was the major impact when the block assessment with 158 BC and BD.
Yes.
But
yes.
Now in the search assessment, this has been removed, that therefore the issuance of notice under section 143(2) yes. Is not mandatory. Thank yes. You very much, Mr. AP Srinivas, for enlightening us on these issues. Now I will, the floor is open for questions. I give the floor to Mr. Anikesh Banerjee.
open for questions.
Sir, one question.
Yes, sir.
The current section 115 BBE.
Yes.
How the applicable with this the such undisclosed income? The total tax impact is coming approximately 88%.
A BBE.
115 BBE.
BBE. Okay. Sendhil or AP Srinivas, who is taking out? Shall I proceed with this one?
Yes, please.
So if you go through the section 158 BBE, this talks about for a cash or any other thing, some found in the deposits in the bank account or anything. Just go through the section for a moment. We will go through it. It's a special section wherein it says that. All those sections of 68, 69, 69A, everything will be applicable. See, because if you take up 68, you will be assessed only in the normal rate of taxes. See, specifically, this was brought in only for the demonetization. Absolutely, this was brought in only for the demonetization period, wherein which any amount which you have deposited in your bank account or any other thing, it is for the assessee to explain it. They brought in a legislation that 158 BB that whatever if any sum found credited in this one, all the sections of 68, 69, 69A, everything will be applicable. And the rate of tax was fixed at the higher rate.
Higher.
That's the problem. In fact, actually, we were suggested by some of the senior advocates or any other thing to make a representation to the finance ministry to include that in the Vivad Se Vishwas scheme to have a reduction of this one. But that was not accepted. Otherwise, most of the assessees would have come for VSV scheme and they would have paid a lesser tax on this one. But the problem is they will not have, interest will not be too high. See, because if I am going to VSP scheme, they will not have that interest portion, but it is better for them to go for VSP scheme. Any other questions, sir?
Any other question from anybody, please? We are already 8:39. It's a very nice program and excellent. We really gathered some lot of knowledge. Any question from your end? And otherwise, the Sumit, please go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yes, please. Anikista. Please, Mr. Agrawal, please.
Actually, in search, the notices are issued under 153A. My question is that I am submitting the return in compliance to 153A under section 139. So, whether whatever I disclose in the returns, that will be treated as the fresh return, the timely, whether it will be a belated return or whatever I have disclosed, whether the penalty will be accrued or not, accrued on it. Because the assessment is done under 153 ABC.
Yes. So
the return filing section is only prescribed under the income tax is 139. So my question that whenever I am submitting the returns, so whether that will be treated as the under 139 and I will get all the privilege of 139.
Yes, let me answer, please. Sir, if you can see this 153A itself, the opening paragraph itself says that notwithstanding anything contained under section 139. Now, when we look into the first subsection 1A, the assessing officer has been empowered to issue notices for 6 assessment years, prescribing the time limit by himself. Normally, in such a cases, the assessing officer gives you a notice. From the date of service of such notices, you are being required to file a return of income as prescribed under the return, within 30 days or 45 days has been chosen by the assessing officer himself. So if the return has been filed within the time limit as prescribed by the assessing officer, the question of levy of penalty that does not arise. But only when a return has been filed beyond the period of what has been prescribed by the assessing officer under 1A, the question of 234A(b)(c) interest will be liable.
Whether that will be treated as the concealment?
No, sir. Once you file a return, it will be accepted under the 153A. Yes. And this was answered by Mr. D.R. Singhalpar. You also asked about all the privileges are applicable. This was precisely answered by Mr. T.R. Singhalpar. We are referring to Rajasthan High Court judgment, which is in favor of revenue. And the latest Bombay High Court judgment, which is in favor of the SSC.
JSW Steel of Bombay High Court in favor of the SSC. You can make a claim what has been left over in the original return also under 153A.
You make a first claim. But by seeing the provisions of section 153A, you cannot make a first claim, sir. So you have to file your return in relation to such. That will be considered. Suppose if anything is admitted in the return, filed in pursuant to notice under 153A or 153C, then the SSC will be absolved from penalty. Of course, the explanation 5A to 271C is applicable and will be absolved, but not the all the privileges as asked by sir will not come, sir. It's our opinion, but Bombay High Court judgment is in your favor.
The AP Srinivas, one problem is that one. See, because issuance of notice by the department should not be a benefit to the SSC. The purpose of 150, see, that's why I would like to specifically mention that, because you can't make a fresh claim or something like that. It's a debatable issue, because we can't give a standard opinion or something like that, because it's a debatable issue. Yes. Because I cannot issue a notice for you to make a fresh claim, which is not at all possible. There are judgments to 148 cannot be benefit to the SSC. We have wonderful judgments.
Both, so far as search is concerned, both states cannot misuse the department also. If there is something missed in one partism, they cannot go for it. At the same time, the SSC also cannot be benefited by inviting a search. So therefore, your first claims cannot be.
Otherwise, standing jeering will be straightly applicable to this case. 148 cannot be a benefit to the SSC. That's what they
did. So there's the same situation here.
Thank you.
Welcome, sir.
I should thank the bar for patiently hearing us virtually. In fact, whether we have taken up, give us the feedback also, whether we have any questions, please.
In fact, I would say that Mr. Anikesh Banerjee, he asked us to deal with search assessment, survey, search seizure, survey, and a search assessment. But we said that search assessment itself is a very big topic which will run for more than an hour. So we hope that we would have addressed some of the provisions of the search assessments and also shared some of our views to our audience of this All Bengal Tax Bar Association. We would like to see what is the feedback from members also, please.
Floor is to the host, sir. Thank you. I think one Mr. Udayan Das Gupta has raised his hands. You can unmute him.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir. Please, sir.
Suppose in case of a search proceedings, I mean in course of search, duplicate sets of personal accounts are unattended by the search party. Suppose there are, in a case there are suppression of purchases, there are suppression of sales, there are suppression of receipts and suppression of expenditure, both. So duplicate sets of personal accounts have been unattended. Naturally, in the course of such proceedings, the same seized personal accounts.
Hello. Yes, sir. Please, sir.
The seized personal accounts will be the main basis on which the search assessment will take place. So naturally, in such cases, there are expenditures recorded in those seized books, which has never been claimed by the SSE in its original proceedings, in its original balance sheet, in its original profit and loss account. Those expenditures have never been claimed. Because there are suppression of purchase and suppression of sales both. So naturally, in such cases, while dealing with such assessments, the deductions that have never been claimed by the SSE in the regular course, in the regular returns, that has to be allowed in such cases. What is your opinion on this?
Yes, sir. Sir, the problem is that one. In such cases, suppose if those in which where you don't have a time limit expired for filing the return of income, your first time filing if itself under 153A or under 153C, in such a situation, you can have an option for claiming a fresh claim or whatever it may be, because your time limit itself has not been expired. But once you have filed your return of income under section 139 in the regular returns of income, which has got abated, then subsequently, because of the notice under section 153A, you want to make a fresh claim. That is not possible, is our view.
Regarding the suppression of purchases that are coming out from the seized books, that has to be considered, isn't it? The suppression of purchases, and I mean the suppression of sales are there. The suppression of receipts are there. The corresponding suppression of purchases are also there. That has to be considered.
Both will be dealt with. Yeah. Both will be dealt in the search assessment. It will be taken care of also. Both the suppression of purchase as well as suppression of sales will be taken care of. Both that claim will be allowed subject to the time if it's not been.
Yes.
It depends upon the facts of each and every facts and circumstance of this case.
That is what
because your time limit for return has been expired, not expired, everything is important for that.
Yes, because otherwise it will be enormous additions without allowing of any expenditures.
Yes. That we already clearly explained, sir. Only for the deductions you are not entitled. Otherwise, all other expenses and all it's those deductions which are circumscribed by time limit, that you cannot exempt by filing a fresh return under 153. Otherwise, what all are the assessment proceedings applicable in normal? It's applicable to such assessment also.
Yes.
That 153A as well as C also talks about the books of account also a material. So yes, that we can make a claim.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. I think one Mr. Advocate Lankaram has raised his hands on the app. Mr. Advocate Lankaram, sir, you have raised your hands. Please kindly unmute yourself so that you can shoot up the questions. I think no questions. I think yes. Yes, lowered his hand. So, yes, sir. I hand over to the host, sir. You can close the. I think there is no questions. I feel so.
I leave it here.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I request Sumit, please deliver the vote of thanks. And thank you, moderator and our two speakers. And we really enjoyed and thank you. I think so. It's a very pleasant for us. And in future, we will expect you for another survey. So I just talked with Mr. Shankar. Surely I will see just to type of teamwork and excellent. So our question and everything. So Sumit, please go ahead, please.
Hello. I'm very thankful to the two speakers, Mr. P.R. Senthil Kumar and Mr. A.P. Srinivas, for excellently explaining the provisions of Section 153A, B, and C, and the differentiation between the old block assessment and the new search assessment. I'm thankful to the moderator, Ms. M. Saminathan, for well conducting the entire session today. Now I will ask Mr. Mithunjay Mukherjee of Durgapur to convey the vote of thanks. Hello. Mr. Mithunjay Mukherjee of Durgapur. Convey the vote of thanks.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Mr.
Sundavacho.
Mithunjay Mukherjee.
Sundavacho. Sundavacho.
We are.
Okay. Thank you.
We are audible.
The secretary and all the executive members of this historic All Bengal Tax Bar Association, we are thanking you, our all the executive members and different members from the different districts of West Bengal. The All Bengal Tax Bar Association was established by our legend tax advocate led Dr. Sardindu Vishwas in 1977. This association is the oldest tax bar association, not only in West Bengal, but also in India. We feel proud that we are the member of this association. All Bengal Tax Bar Association working, All Bengal Tax Bar Association, All Bengal Tax Bar Association, you cannot start your video because, okay. Hello? Hello? Audible? Sumit?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. So, All Bengal Tax Bar Association working and guiding since 1977 now for the benefit of the tax lawyers in case of different professional hazards faced by our tax lawyers and giving support of continuous learning and upgradation of the lawyers by organizing physical conference and like this type of webinar. I am thanking you, Mr. M. Saminathan sir, for sparing the valuable time with us and giving explanation on the historic relation between the Calcutta and Madras High Court and correlation between them. I am also thanking you, sir, for moderating this program systematically, and we are grateful to you, sir, really. And we are expecting in future you that we will give your cooperation for organizing this type of seminar. Next, I am thanking you, Mr. T.R. Senthil Kumar sir and Mr. A.P. Srinivasan sir for thanking you for your grateful. So we are grateful to you, sir, for giving the elaborate discussion on the subject of the income tax laws and mainly in the topic of search and assessment. Sir, we are expecting that in future we will get your cooperation like this for organizing this type of seminar. I also thank you, Onikesh Banerjee, for his tremendous support for organizing these types of webinar and for enriching our advocates by his continuous touch with our association. at last, I thanking you, my members, colleagues, friends, for participating in this webinar for the grand success. Thanking you all. Thanking you everyone.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you
all the members of all Bengal Tax Bar Association.
Thank you.